It is time for X's and O's talk here at Mark Rogers TV, the voice of college football, as we break down the best games and matchups each and every day. We got Justin DiTavio on the line. You can catch him at Ironman Football. Also does work at State of the U, the SB Nation platform for Miami football. Hey, Justin, how you doing today?
Good, good. Just here at work, doing the teaching gig.
There you go. There you go. Teaching and coaching and doing a really good job for us each and every week, breaking down the X's and O's. So this is a segment that we would like all of you to lock in on. You're going to learn something if you check us out each and every week with Justin and his breakdown of what he sees on film, specifically with Miami and across the ACC in the country. North Carolina, wow, 5 wins in 2 years. They win their first two games under Mack Brown against quality opponents, regardless of what South Carolina's record is going to be because of their brutal schedule. And Miami, who knows if they're going to pull it together, but I will call these two teams easily top 40 teams in America, and North Carolina gets a win both times. So we see a quarterback in Sam Howell who went for the jugular and connected on those passes. We saw a quarterback in Jaren Williams who put it up 39 times and seemed to be a little bit more aware in the pocket of what his offensive line was capable or not capable of doing, more so than he was against Florida. So what's your quick takeaway from the quarterback play?
Yeah, I mean, I was really excited about Sam Howell when he was coming out for the December signing class, going early enrollee. I thought he was going to be really, really good. Florida State had a hold on him. They thought they owned him. I, you know, I heard some people say that, that they did not, and that he was still kind of looking around. But he went with Mack Brown, UNC. He's a North Carolina kid, so he sort of stayed home and wasn't going to go down to Miami. Did not wind up going to Florida State. He stayed home, and obviously it was a really good choice. You know, he's already the starting quarterback. They're 2-0. He's looked very, very efficient. I mean, I think against Miami, he averaged like 11 yards per passing attempt. He's looked very, very good. As good, if not better, than I expected him. I thought he was going to be really good. So. With Williams, I think it's a little bit more, it's taken some time. I think last year was obviously just sort of a throwaway with, completely pretty much redshirting him and not really giving him any work. That was a big mistake. And I think that, he's a little bit underdeveloped, but I think he's also playing really well. He's making sure to complete passes. But at times his yards per attempt is a little low, right? It was about 7.5, I think, versus UNC. And that, he's not throwing interceptions, which is great, but he's also kind of fumbled the ball when he's been hit. He didn't lose either of them, I don't think, he did not. There was no turnovers, but, so I think he's doing good things. I think he improved from week 1 to week 2, but also, defense wasn't quite Florida's level, that he was going against. But, I think Jaren Williams has a very strong future. I think Sam Howell obviously is a really, really high ceiling.
So, Justin, when we look at Miami's approach, taking in the Florida game, now taking in the effort against North Carolina, let's see, they scored 20 points. They scored 25 points. Their positives and negatives for the Canes on offense seem to be very, very definite. The offensive line struggles. The quarterback's inexperienced. The running back, DJ Dallas in particular, also Cam Harris, very talented, plenty of weapons on the outside, great tight ends. They seem to have a pocket of positives and negatives that are well-defined. How do you think the play calling has worked with what they have to work with?
Well, and I think the offensive line, obviously UNC's defense isn't as good as Florida, like we said, but I think the offensive line played better. They moved some guys around. They brought a true freshman into play guard. They moved DJ Scaife back out to tackle, which is where I thought he was really good last year, playing right tackle. So they have a true freshman playing left tackle. And I didn't think that they did that poorly. I think there was a lot of improvement there. I think they're getting well coached and that they're going to improve drastically by the end of the season. And I think they did some really good things. Obviously, the run game was there. DJ Dallas and Cam Harris both ran really, really well. So I think the run blocking is there. It's the pass protection that lacks at times with a lot of the different blitzes and stunts that they see. But I think sometimes the play calling isn't really lending itself to the benefits of a young quarterback and young offensive line because of the under center stuff. Williams is constantly having to turn his back. Well, they had a play, and it was in my breakdown of the game, my film review from the UNC game where Navon Donaldson's like 357 pounds, was asked to come all the way across the formation and kick out a rushing outside linebacker 34 scheme who just outran it, right? And Williams got lit up. That's bad coaching. You know, like if you stick your fast outside linebacker out there in practice and time that up a couple times and you get beat, you just assume you're getting beat in the game, like, and you move on. That's just not something that you're going to do this week. It seems like at times they're really hell bent on sticking with under center and some of the slow developing play action. It's putting yourself in a bad position. You're having a young quarterback put his back to the defense. So he's not seeing who's coming. He can't throw, you know, to a hot read, you know, a rush route. And so we're not seeing coaching necessarily in the scheme to what you've got. You know, you're just kind of calling it to what worked somewhere else, and that's not adjusting to what you have there. You know, I think they could run the whole game out of shotgun, let him have his eyes on the field the entire time, never turning his back to pressure or his targets. And I think he would do a lot better in that style of play.
Justin Tatavio joining us here at Mark Rogers TV, the voice of college football. I want to remind you that I've got my weekly predictions available at the Voice of College Football community. Just grab the link next to the Voice of College Football community down in the description section below. 31-20 against the spread the last 2 weeks would make you some money, and also got a deal with betnow.eu. Go to that link down below next to the hashtag Sam Strong. It's for great cause, St. Jude Hospital, a number of YouTubers and volunteer roadshow teaming up with betnow.eu, and you get 100% added to the money you put in, so you can't beat that. All right, Justin, in regards to Bethune-Cookman, this is the game this week. It should be, you know, whatever Miami wants the score to be for the most part. Do they take this as a week in which we expand the playbook, or do we look at what we're doing well or what we're not doing well, but we want to continue to work on and really size it down and try to work on some certain plays or certain types of plays to get better for Virginia Tech coming up after that?
You definitely do not expand the playbook against an opponent that you feel like you are going to dominate, right? This is not Michigan App State from 2007 or anything like that. This is just a team that, you know, Bethune-Cookman is good. They're just not great. They're a good FCS team. They're not a great one. They're not a team that could be bumped up easily to FBS. So I don't think there's a concern there. I think it's about going to, you know, the dozen things that you really, really want to do well and just executing them over and over again the first half, and then letting the backups get in and execute 8 or 9 things really, really well for the second half. It's about seeing who your depth is. It's really about, you know, getting these other quarterbacks on the field. You know, if Nikosi Perry can get out there on the field, even if you've got freshmen, I mean, you have 4 games, you might as well let him play in this thing. So, you know, why not give him even a drive at the end of the fourth quarter? You know, you might as well get guys some work in case something happens. You never know what's going to happen. You might as well get guys some work. So there, that's what I would focus on personally. You know, if you had a preseason-y type game, you know, if our high school season had some kind of like preseason game in the middle, it didn't count, it would be great, because then you could build and build and build and then go forget it and go all the way back to day one and do the things that you would do, you know, maybe day 2 or 3, and not all these little adjustments and extra this and extra that, you know, and keep it much more simple and go back over it. We don't get that pleasure. You know, we don't really have Bethune-Cookmans, and, you know, the cupcake games in a high school schedule don't really exist. They might be like week 1, and after that it's over. So we don't get that pleasure, but they have the opportunity for a couple of tough games to go back to the playbook, hit reset, get really good at the base plays.
Justin, North Carolina has been one of the worst Power 5 teams the past 2 years. Prior to that, they were winning. They went to an ACC championship game. Larry Fedora recruited reasonably well. If you look at the recruiting rankings, they're generally in the 20s. So the roster has some semblance of talent. I know that they've gotten hit by injury more than most teams the last few years. And obviously the recruiting rankings don't speak to the development, and they had all sorts of issues there to the point where they were losing games to lower end group of 5 teams like in East Carolina by three scores at times and struggling against FCS opponents. In comes Mac Brown. He finds a quarterback, gets him signed. He plays right out of the gate. I don't expect them to go 10-2 or anything like that, but they certainly look on their road to 7 or 8 or 9 wins, possibly, depending on. They took on two worthy opponents and took them out the first 2 weeks of the season. You know, what happened here with North Carolina? And again, I know it's only two games, but it was repeated the next week that they beat another decent opponent. And, you know, they get a respected head coach with credibility. They get a quarterback. Is it more to it than that?
Yeah, it is. You know, Larry Fedora's only really good seasons at UNC were with Seth Luttrell as the offensive coordinator. Well, he went to North Texas and they started scoring a ton of points, and all of a sudden the offense falls apart. So sometimes you are only as good as your assistant coaches. And if he was unable to find somebody of that quality to come in and do the job, right, then, you know, maybe that's where some of it slumped off. There were the suspensions and injuries and stuff. But, you know, sometimes it's recruiting. Mac Brown's going to recruit really well in North Carolina and the surrounding states. I mean, he was at University of Texas, won a national championship. Everybody knows who he is. But I think you have to look even deeper. Bateman from, you know, Army West Point, who's defensive coordinator, and Longo, who's the offensive coordinator from Ole Miss. Go back and look at what Ole Miss is doing right now on offense. Nothing. What were they doing last year, the year before? You know, when he got there, they all of a sudden became an offensive power. As soon as he leaves, you go right back to what Ole Miss has always been, which is a 5-win team, right? So I think that's a lot of it. I mean, I think the guy found his quarterback, brought him in, could start him right away, and has a system. I think Longo's a great coach. I think Bateman's a really good coach too. They both are very big on fundamentals and on keeping it very simple and very basic in order for the opponent to be confused, but you to understand what you're doing. So I think it's a lot of that too. I think the way Mac Brown runs a program lends himself to these younger coordinators that are really good, because he's not going to get in the way of the football stuff. He's just doing the handshaking CEO, you know, president-y type stuff, but he's out there recruiting and people want their kid to play for him, especially in the Carolinas, you know, in Georgia and stuff, where people know who he is and they're having success right away. I mean, you know, with, you know, Fedora, you know, when Luttrell was there, obviously had success. It was Butch Davis's kids for a little bit of that. And then all of a sudden it kind of slumped off, right? So then now I think you're looking at what could have been with really good coaching, and they have a really good coach.
And what Mac Brown did the first time around was suffer through 2-1-10 seasons right out of the gate after taking over, obviously, a struggling program. And by the end of it, he was posting top 10 finishes in the country with 10 and 11 wins the last 2 years. Love this segment with Justin DiTavio here each and every week. We learn a lot, breaks down the X's and O's for Miami and whoever else he catches throughout the week. So we want you to catch this segment each and every week right here at Mark Rogers TV, the voice of college football. Justin, we appreciate you stopping by.
Appreciate it, man. Thank you.